بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. In the name of Allah, the entirely merciful, the especially merciful. All praise belongs to Allah, peace and blessings of Allah be upon our beloved the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and those who follow him rightly and correctly till the day of resurrection. Dear brothers and sisters, I would like first and foremost at the outset of this talk to salute you all with the salutation of peace, with the salutation of love, with the salutation of the people of paradise. تحيتهم يوم يلقونه سلام فسلام الله عليكم ورحمته وبركاته. And it gives me a great pleasure today to speak to you and to chat with you and to discuss with you some issues related to our religion and some issues related to half of the society, that is women. Always I believe that women should talk about the issues of women. Women, or in particular Muslim women, should defend the women, not men. It would be more compelling argument for a woman to highlight the status of women in Islam. However, when I was asked to speak about this topic, or when I was asked to speak to you, I chose this topic after a few days of thinking about the topic. I decided and I chose to speak about this topic in particular due to mainly two reasons. First of which, the rise of the feminist movements nowadays in the Muslim land in general, and in particular in our country, in Oman, there are feminist movements that they are promoting, let's say, rebellion against not only their male counterparts, not only against their society, not only against their traditions, but also against their creator, against their Lord. These feminist movements not only asking women to rebel against the society, against the tradition of the community, but against their religion, against their Lord. And in some cases, this reached to the level of encouraging young girls, young women, even to commit a suicide. And we have a famous case related to this, in which in an incident, a young female committed suicide because she was encouraged to do so by some feminist advocates. So this is one reason why I chose to speak about this topic today. It is because our society is really in danger. So it's part of our religion. It is part of our obligation as members of the Muslim community to correct the misunderstanding, to clear up any misconception, and to bring back the Muslim lady or the young Muslims in general to the right track, to the straight path, the path of Islam. So this is the first reason why I chose to talk about this topic in particular. The second reason is what I saw trending on social media about Muslim women, especially nowadays and over the course of 2 weeks or so, when Muslim fighters defeated a colonial army or invaders in some Muslim lands. We had a trend because after that defeat, those invaders didn't have anything to cover their defeat except to victimize Muslim women, to cry or to outcry for Muslim women. So there was a trend on social media, on Twitter, and some social media platforms that are victimizing Muslim women in that particular country. And they are expecting the worst from the Muslim community to when it comes to treating Muslim women, and they expecting the worst when it comes to Muslim education and to Muslim women work and so on and so forth. So this is only to cover their defeat. It's not about protecting women. In fact, women suffered the worst during their invasion, and now they're trying to cover their defeat by victimizing Muslim women. If any of you follows the social media or the mass media, not only the social media, even the mass media coverage is biased against Muslims in general, especially the English-speaking media, even some Arabic-speaking media, they are biased against Muslims in general and against Muslim women, and they cannot comprehend that they have been trying to distorting the image of Islam in that particular country for 20 years. And all of a sudden, they praise these people for their handling the current situation, for successfully handling the current situation. So all that they are able to do is to victimize the Muslim women, to show Muslim women as victims. So this is the reason why I chose to talk about this particular topic today. And we should know that Islam gave women their rights long, long before the Western civilization, long before the Western democracies and the modern day democracies and secularism, before the secular world. In fact, what is called the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. This was a United Nations declaration. It was relatively issued recently compared to that of Islam. It was issued what is called the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. This was issued in just shortly after the establishment of the United Nations in about 1948. While the Quran, while the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, while Islam in general gave women these rights that were mentioned and gave humans in general these rights that were mentioned in the United Nations Declaration of Human Rights 14 or 1300 years ago, long, long, long before the United Nations was founded or established in the just before or after the Second World War. When Islam came, what I mean by Islam here, strictly speaking, the message of Muhammad, peace be upon him, bearing in mind that the word Islam in its wider sense applies to the messages of all prophets, of all preceding and previous prophets and messengers of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The message of Islam is the message of Adam, of Noah, of Abraham, of Moses, of Jesus, and all prophets and messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But strictly speaking, when I mention here that Islam came to give back women their rights, I mean here the advent and the message of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, in the 7th century Arabia. in the 7th century Arabia and elsewhere in the world, women were treated just as a commodity. They would be sold and bought, and they would be inherited. If a husband dies and he leaves behind a wife, his son from the other wife could come and claim this wife, his father's wife, other than his mother, and inherit her. And this is a practice prevalent when Islam came in Arabia, in the 7th century Arabia. And the Quran, the Holy Quran, made a reference to this heinous practice when the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا تَنْكِحُوا مَا نَكَحَ آبَاءُكُمْ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ إِلَّا مَا قَدْ سَلَفُ إِنَّهُ كَانَ فَاحِشَةً وَمَقْتًا وَلَا وَسَاءَ سَبِيلًا. The Quran here refers to a particular type of marriage. It is called the maqti marriage, the hateful marriage, literally speaking, the disliked marriage. When the son inherits his father's wife other than his mother, and he marries her. This is called al-maqti marriage. Islam came, and the Holy Quran categorically prohibits this type of marriage when the Almighty says, وَلَا تَنْكِحُوا مَا نَكَحَ آبَاءُكُمْ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ إِلَّا مَا قَدْ سَلَفَ إِنَّهُ كَانَ فَاحِشَةً وَمَقْتًا وَسَاءَ سَبِيلًا. And don't marry those women whom your fathers married, except what has passed or what happened in the past. إِنَّهُ كَانَ فَاحِشَةً. It is an act of indecency. It is indecent. وَمَقْتًا. It is hateful and heinous crime. وَسَاءَ سَبِيلًا. And that is an evil way as well. So when Islam came, a woman was a property that was inherited. And Islam came to give her the opposite to that situation, to grant her inheritance. After being herself inherited, Islam gave her inheritance, share in inheritance. And this is clearly handled by the Holy Quran, when the Almighty says, لِلرِّجَالِ نَصِيبٌ مِمَّا تَرَكَ الْوَالِدَانِ وَالْأَقْرَبُونَ وَلِلنِّسَاءِ نَصِيبٌ مِمَّا تَرَكَ الْوَالِدَانِ وَالْأَقْرَبُونَ مِمَّا قَلَّ مِنْهُ أَوْ كَثُرَ نَصِيبًا مَفْرُوضًا. For men is a share of what the parents and close relatives leave. And here the verse says, continues on to say, وَلِلنِّسَاءِ نَصِيبٌ مِمَّا تَرَكَ الْوَالِدَانِ وَالْأَقْرَبُونَ. And for women, a share of what the parents and the close relatives leave behind. مِمَّا قَلَّ مِنْهُ أَوْ كَثُرُ. Even if it is small estate, even if it is a small portion of money, the woman has to take her right from this inheritance. مِمَّا قَلَّ مِنْهُ أَوْ كَثُرُ. Be it little or much or so much, she has to take her portion of the inheritance. مِمَّا قَلَّ مِنْهُ أَوْ كَثُرْ نَصِيبًا مَفْرُوضًا. An obligatory share, an obligatory share obliged and assigned to her by Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is interesting to note here two things. First, this is an obligatory portion that have to be given to her, which means no one can decline the inheritance of his father, of his mother, of his children, of his wife, of her husband. One has to take this. This is an obligatory share. Yes, he can then donate it. He can then return it back to the rest of the inheritors. But at the beginning, he cannot decline it. First, it has to enter into his possession. It has to be his or hers. Then they can dispose it as they like. They can donate it. They can give it back to the rest of the family members, to the rest of the heirs. But it has to be accepted at the beginning. This is interesting. Nasiban mafruḍa. This is assigned, obligatory, share each one. Be it male or female, he has to accept it. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has signed to him or to her. This is an interesting point when it comes to inheritance laws in Islam or the inheritance system in Islam. Another interesting fact when it comes to inheritance, that the details of inheritance are not left to the diligence or the understanding or the reasoning of the later Muslim scholars. It was then enshrined and specified by the Holy Quran, by the very words of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they subsequently explained by the tradition of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So the basic principles of inheritance system in Islam was mentioned clearly and explicitly in the Holy Quran. So that's why there is less arguments regarding the basic, in fact, there is no argument regarding the basic fundamentals of inheritance system in Islam, because simply they are mentioned in the Holy Quran. They are clearly explained and mentioned in the Holy Quran, including these shares and laws related to women. And here I would like to refer to a misconception that is raised from time to time by Western Orientalists and by Western media, biased media against Islam, that Islam doesn't give women inheritance or doesn't do justice to women, and gives Islam gives women half of a man's share and so on and so forth. Quoting the verse, لِلرِّجَالِ, quoting the verse that says, لِلْذَكَرِ مِثْلُ حَبِّ الْأُنْثَيَنِ, for the male, what is equal to the share of two females. Many, they quote this as a proof, supporting proof for their argument or for their conception, or in fact, misconception. And to clear this, we should know that the Quran, it is an interesting linguistic point here I would like to refer to. The Quran doesn't say that a man takes or a woman takes half what the man takes, or a woman receives half of the her male counterparts receives. No, the Quran doesn't say the woman receives half. The Quran states that each woman takes her share, and it is only in some cases the male takes two shares of a woman for the male, what is equal to the share of two women. So each woman takes her own share. No woman takes half of her share or half of the man's share. This is an interesting linguistic point if we think about it. And the context, the Quranic context, is talking about a specific situation or specific case. It doesn't give a blanket ruling, as they say. It doesn't give a ruling applies to all situations. In fact, a woman receives, to clarify this and to refute this misconception, we should note that And everybody should note that. And the Orientalists and those who doubt Islamic inheritance system and the justice of Islamic inheritance laws, they should know that only women take or a male take double what the female takes in only four occasions, not in every single inheritance occasion. While on the other hand, a female receives equal to what the male receives in 10 occasions. And even more, the female receives more what the male receives in 16 occasions. If the female receives less than the male in 4 occasions, then they should know that the same female could receive more than the male in not only 4 occasions, in 16 occasions, 4 times more than that of the male. So it all goes down to the proximity to the deceased. I mean, the female proximity or the male even proximity to the deceased, the relationship, how strong the relationship to the deceased, and also to the financial responsibilities that Islam gave, because as a matter of fact, Islam gave more financial responsibility on the male than the female. So Islam, we should know that Islam is a religion of justice. Islam is the religion of nature. Islam is there to support and to give everybody what he or she needs. And this is the difference between what is called equality and equity. Islam is not about just equality. Islam goes even further behind that. It is about equity. Equality is, we call it in Arabic, al-musawa, equality, which means that you give everyone the same portion, the same amount. While equity, which is synonymous to fairness and justice, equity means to give each one what he needs, what meet his needs or her needs. And this is a level beyond equality, and this is a level higher than equality. So Islam doesn't just give equal shares, but Islam here fulfills what is called fairness, justice, and equity. He considers the situation of each individual and her or his financial responsibilities. So this is an important issue that one should bear in mind. Let me give you another example of equality and equity. Let's assume a man has two sons or even two daughters. One of the two daughters is a young daughter. She goes only to the nursery, while the other daughter, her older sister, goes to the university. So if we want only to achieve equality, then we should give them the father should give them the same amount of money. If he gives the young girl who goes to nursery, for example, 20 Omani riyals a month or 30 Omani riyals a month, then also he must give the lady or his other daughter who goes to the university only 30 Omani riyals a month to achieve equality. But that does not achieve fairness, justice, because the needs of the daughter who goes to university might be more than that her younger sister. So here, when we achieve equality, we did, on the other hand, injustice, unfairness to the older sister or the older daughter of this man. But if we need to, if we want to achieve justice and equity and fairness, then the father should look at the needs of both of them and should give each one of them what he, what fulfills her needs. So if he gives, if he see that the needs of the young daughter can be fulfilled and can be met by 30 umaniyas, the needs of the younger or the older daughter might be only met by 100 umaniyas or 150 umaniyas or whatever meets her needs. So Islam is the religion of nature. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator who created us, and he is the one who knows our needs. And that's why he set his rules based on his ultimate knowledge and based on his divine wisdom. The Almighty says, أَلَا يَعْلَمُ مَنْ خَلَقَ وَهُوَ اللَّطِيفُ الْخَبِيرُ. Doesn't he know he who created, وَهُوَ اللَّطِيفُ, the gentle, the subtle, al-khabir, the all-aware. So Islam doesn't seek to please Western media and doesn't seek to please modern-day secularism and doesn't seek to advocate or advance feminist agenda. Islam, the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sets rules and regulations to meet the needs of every single one of us. So this is an important that we should bear in mind. This is a misconception that we should be aware of, that Islam gave the woman its rights and its share, her share of inheritance. After a woman was a property that was inherited herself, which was nikah al-mahdi, the hateful kind of marriage. So this is one of the things that was practiced in the pre-Islamic era and the pre-Islamic times. So the Islam gives women their rights, and Islam came to honor women, Islam came to dignify women, to give women their dignity. Islam came to promote equality, equity, fairness, and justice, not only to women, but to all members of the society. So we should be careful when we listen to the social or mass media that Islam didn't do justice to women when it comes to, for example, inheritance and so on and so forth. Also, when it comes to education, these invaders, these colonial powers, now they are crying and victimizing Muslim, and they're claiming they will not be giving the right to education. First, let me clarify one thing. When we talk about the Muslim community in general, we are talking about the rules that Islam have set and the purposes that Islam have set for both genders and the rights that Islam have set for both gender. We don't want to tie Islam's rules and regulation to the misapplication of a particular society or mistreatment of women of a particular society. Yes, there might be misapplications when it comes to applying the rules of Islam. There might be misrepresentation of Islamic rules and regulations. They might take into the harshest sense, which Islam doesn't approve. So we're not here talking about the practice of a particular Muslim community or a particular Muslim household. There are always exceptions to the rule. There are always odd cases. So we're not talking about that. This happens even in the best society, we don't have an ideal society even that than that of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. During the time of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, the best generation, the best people ever lived on the surface of the earth are the companions of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Yet we find that the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, held many of them accountable for major crimes they have committed. Some individual cases, exceptional cases, and odd cases are always there. We should not generalize the odd cases to the whole community. If we see a misapplication of some rules in a particular country or in particular on particular occasions, we should paint all with the same brush. We shouldn't generalize the rules of this particular people or this particular misapplication to the whole Muslim community. We should be just and fair and give every society its justice and fairness. So this is an important issue to highlight. And when it comes to Western media and mass media, and in fact, when we look at the Western societies today, those who claim to give the women's rights to wear whatever they want to wear, to be protected, and so on and so forth, these societies are not ideal either. In fact, there are more crimes, I would say this confidently, because I lived in the West for a short, not a long period of time, for a short period of time. And I can confidently say there are more crimes, more marital problems, more gender problems in the West than in the East. In fact, in 2015, I was reading a local newspaper in the UK, in one of the cities in the UK, and the report says that there are in 2014 there were around 135,000 documented cases of sexual assault and harassment against women. 135,000 documented cases, and highlight here the word documented cases in the court, presented to the court, taken to the court of sexual harassment and sexual assaults and rapes against women in the UK in a single year. So this is an alarming number. And if we consider that these only the documented cases, we should note that the undocumented cases, the number of undocumented cases of sexual assaults, rapes, and harassments against women is much, much larger than the documented cases, because women many a times tend to ignore or neglect cases of sexual harassment against them, and usually they don't take it to the court. So this shows you the women's rights in the West, and we're not talking here about women's rights 100 years ago or hundreds of years ago. We are talking about the present day. Nowadays, there are many more, according to statistics in the United States of America, 60% of men in the United States have extra or at least had an extramarital relationship. Those who are married have extramarital relationship and affairs with other women other than their wives. So that is 60% of the American married men have extra, or at least they had that at a certain point in their marital life, and an affair with a third or another woman other than their wives. While the West now waging a war against polygamy, we find that they substitute polygamy, which is having a second wife, with mistress, which is having a friend beside, girlfriend beside his wife. And even today, the Christian communities in Africa, they are more polygamous than the Muslim communities. Believe it or not, in the Republic of Congo, which is a Christian majority country, the rate of polygamy is around 31% of men are polygamous. The 30% of the Congo population, of men of the Congo population, are polygamous, meaning having more than one wife. And the same applies to many Christian African nations. And even beyond Islam and Christianity, in India, for example, Islam is the least polygamous religion in India. If we take as an example, in India, polygamy is practiced wider by Hindus, not only Muslim, by a higher rate than that of Muslims, and by other religions in India as well. So Islam is the least religion practicing polygamy in India and also in Africa, compared, for example, to Christianity. So the argument that Islam does injustice to women doesn't stand in reality. And there are a number of misconceptions here I may quote when it comes to Islam rights, and I'm sure that I will not be able to cover all misconceptions raised by Western media nowadays. The issue of polygamy itself, it's not an Islam unique issue. If we read the Bible, we find the biblical figures, figures, and the biblical prophets, many of them have more than one wife, like Abraham, the prophet Abraham, who is considered the founder of the three Abrahamic religions, Although I have a reservation about this term, the Abrahamic religions, Islam, Christianity, and Judaism, because we believe undoubtedly that Abraham was a Muslim prophet, not a prophet of three religions. And this is clearly stated in the Holy Quran, when the Almighty says, "Ma kana Ibrahimu Yahudiyan wala Nasraniya, walakin kana Hanifan Musliman wa ma kana min al-mushrikeen." Ibrahim was neither a Jew nor was he a Christian. Rather, he was Hanifan Musliman. He is inclining to the truth. He is a Muslim inclining to the truth. So this term, the Abrahamic religions, or the three Abrahamic religions, we should not actually use it, because it is against the Quranic statement, ما كان إبراهيم يهوديا ولا نصرانيا, and the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in another verse, إن أولى الناس بإبراهيم للذين اتبعوا وهذا النبي, meaning Muhammad, والذين آمنوا والله ولي المؤمنين. the people who have more right to Ibrahim, those who follow him, those who strictly follow him, and وهذا النبي, and this prophet, the prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So Ibrahim, back to our topic, was polygamous, meaning having more than one wife. He is married to Sarah, the mother of Isaac, and he is married to Hajar, the mother of Ismail. And also the Bible tells us about so many wives of the Prophet Solomon as well. And the same applies to many of the biblical figures. So when it comes to polygamy, Islam came to limit and regulate polygamy, because polygamy before Islam was limitless. So Islam came to limit it and regulate it and stipulate conditions on it. On top of them is the condition of justice, treating the wives equally, treating them with justice and with the grace. And this is clearly stated in the Holy Quran, فَإِنْ خِفْتُمْ أَلَّا تَعْدِلُوا فَوَاحِدَةً. If you fear that you will not be just to all of your wife, then one wife is sufficient. Stick to one wife, which is called monogamy. So this is what is related to polygamy. There are other issues of education, for example, of women's work. The Western media claims that Islam prevents women from education, or certain communities prevent women from education. When we look at the biography of the Prophet, peace be upon him, the Prophet, peace be upon him, designated a day for women. When they come and they ask, meet the Prophet and ask him questions related to their religion. And that was known of the women of Al-Ansar, the helpers, who helped the Prophet, peace be upon him, and who hosted him in Al-Medina. So much so, Aisha, radiallahu ta'ala anha, says, Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her and her father, says, رحم الله نساء الأنصار. May Allah have mercy on the women of Al-Ansar. لم يمنعهن الحياء أن يتفقهن في الدين. The shyness, this beautiful quality of shyness, didn't prevent them from seeking knowledge, from coming to the Prophet, peace be upon him, majlis, or sitting and asking the Prophet, peace be upon him, questions related to their religion. And they come and ask the Prophet, peace be upon him, many questions. Even some questions are difficult, if I can use this word, difficult question, because they are related to the private life that between men and women, and related to ghusl al-janaba, having the ritual bathing and so on and so forth. When it comes to work, Islam approved of women working as long as she is decent, modest, doesn't go beyond of the norms of chastity. So an example of that is Rufayda al-Aslamiyya. She would go with the Prophet, peace be upon him, in his wars, and she would treat the injury. She were a nurse that would treat the injuries and the injured soldiers of Muslims. Her name is Rufayda al-Aslamiyya, Khadija bint Khuwaylid, the first wife of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was a businesswoman, and the Prophet, peace be upon him, approved that. So this means, as long as the woman is doing her business modestly, in modesty, chastity, and without exposing, for example, what should be covering, then that is fine. She can go to the business world, no problem with that. In fact, she should set a good example for the other Muslim women, that a woman could still work in the business world if she is decent, if she is modest, and if she avoids exposing or putting on or wearing what attracts the attention of the opposite sex. So this is one thing that we should pay attention. And so one of the things related to hijab, I referred here earlier, the hijab of a woman, and she goes, when she goes to work, she should wear her hijab. And the hijab is the head cover. When we say a hijab, we doesn't mean the face veil. That is something optional for a woman. That is something might be preferable in some circumstances, or might be even obligatory in some circumstances when a woman fears for herself. And when she thinks that she would attract the attention of people. So a woman should, generally speaking, adopt this obligation, the hijab obligation, the head scarf, the head cover obligation, to avoid attracting the opposite sex attention. And I remember, actually, a few weeks ago, exactly a month ago, exactly on this day a month ago, on the 27th of July, I was at the airport, at the international airport here. I was flying abroad, so I was walking with my children at the airport, and in front of me, a woman that is not covered, and a man passed by her. I didn't hear anything, only I heard that woman, the uncovered woman, shouting at him with the loudest voice she could do. And she not only insulted him, she insulted his parents as well. So this is a result, although the man, if he says a word of sexual harassment to her, that is a mistake. But that is, he wouldn't have said that if she were a modest and covered woman. I can understand from her accent, and everybody in the airport heard what she said. She not only insulted him, she insulted both of his parents, and with the disgusting words. So if she is covered, if she is a modest woman, that man wouldn't have, I mean, sexually or verbally harass her. So this is a result of her not being covered, not being modest in a public place. And that's why hijab is part and parcel of our religion. It is an obligation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructed the not only the believer, the women of the believers, but also the best generation, the prophet's wives, to dress modestly and put on their head cover when the Almighty says, وَلْيَضْرِبْنَ بِخُمُرِهِنَّ عَلَى جُيُوبِهِنَّ, and let them draw. خُمُرِهِنَّ, al-khimar is a term used for the headscarf. وَلْيَضْرِبْنَ بِخُمُرِهِنَّ عَلَى جُيُوبِهِنَّ, let bring down and rub part of their khimar on their chest. And in other verse, the Quran uses the word jilbab, which is an outer garment and the bigger form of head's cover that covers the head and the rest of the body. The Almighty says, يا أيها النبي قل لأزواجك وبناتك ونساء المؤمنين يدنين عليهن من جلابهن. O Prophet of Allah, tell the believing, قل لأزواج, tell your wives, وقل لأزواجك وبناتك and your daughters, ونساء المؤمنين and the wives of the believers, يدنين عليهن من جلابيبهن. Bring down the headscarf from the top of their head and to the rest of their body. ذلك أدنى أن يعرفن فلا يؤذين. So the Quran here makes a reference that one of the purposes of the head cover is that the woman is not harassed. ذلك أدنى أن يعرفن فلا يؤذين. The woman is not harassed by unrelated men. Yes, a woman can expose her beauty in her house, for example, for her husband and for her related, closely related men, like her son, her sons, her brothers, her uncles, her father-in-law, and so on and so forth. She can expose her beauty to these people, but not to unrelated men, because they might be harassed. And before we even think of these aims, goals, and purposes of al-hijab, a woman should know, and a Muslim, whether he is male or whether she is a female, should know that when we have a commandment, a divine commandment of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we should willingly surrender to the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whether we know the wisdom or we don't know the wisdom, we believe that there is always a wisdom behind any commandment coming from Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whether we know it or we don't know it. The simple fact that Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructed us to do so is sufficient to abide by these commandments and to comply with these instructions. This is sufficient because we know that the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is our creator and he knows what is best for us. أَلَا يَعْلَمُ مَنْ خَلَقَ وَهُوَ اللَّطِيفُ الْخَبِيرُ. And also he will hold us accountable in the hereafter. And this life is a life of test. Even if we don't know or don't recognize or identify a particular purpose of doing so, we should submit because we are in a test room, an exam room. So we should abide by the instruction of the teacher in order for us to succeed. It is a short period of time. It would be over soon. And on the day of judgment, we will be held responsible about whether we abide by these rules or we disobeyed the commandments of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This should be always the status of Muslim. And this is the very meaning of the word Muslim. The Muslim is someone who surrender and to give up his will to the will of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And only when he does so, he will deserve the title of Islam. He would be entitled to this name, the name of Islam. I think we're running out of time. And I'm not really sure if any of you has a question. The issue of misconceptions related to Islam in general and to women in particular is a vast topic. So from the beginning, I didn't have a hope to cover all aspects of this topic. And because we're running out of time, I should respect your time. Unless you have a question, feel free to unmute yourself.
Sheikh?
Yes.
Can I ask you a question, please?
Go ahead, Sister Aisha.
I have been asked this question by a Christian, mm-hmm. that how can you justify the words, I'm sorry, I forget the exact surah and the exact lines, which say that a man has the right to beat a woman, to chastise a woman.
Yes,
and I said that this depends on interpretation. It depended on the time. Those were different days, but still the argument was, it has been written in the book. And how do you justify that?
Okay, thank you, Sister Aisha, for this interesting question. Actually, this was one of the issues I wished I had time to talk about. And you refer to a verse in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4 of the Holy Quran, وَالَّتِي تَخَافُونَ, the verses, وَالَّتِي تَخَافُونَ نُشُوزَهُنَّ فَعِظُوهُنَّ وَهَجُرُوهُنَّ فِي الْمَضَاجِعِ وَضَرِبُوهُنَّ فَإِنْ أَطَعْنَكُمْ فَلَا تَبْغُوا عَلَيْهِنَّ سَبِيلًا إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ عَلِيًّا كَبِيرًا. وَالَّتِي تَخَافُونَ نُشُوزَهُنَّ, those who disobey you, those who are stubborn of your wives, فَعِظُوهُنَّ. Then first, the first thing to do is to admonish them, is to give them advice. وَهْجُرُوهُنَّ فِي الْمَضَاجِعِ, and to turn your back towards them. It doesn't have to be leaving the room or leaving the house, just turning the back during sleep time. If the first thing fails, which is the advice and the admonishment, and if the second thing fails, which is turning one's back to his wife, if he fails to obey him in matters that is in line with the commandment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then he may resort to the third. And the third thing, the word said daraba. And the way we should understand this in the general context, first of the verse, of the whole verse, the verses just before it and the verses after it. The verses before it, الرجال قوامون على النساء. Men are doing قوامة to women. قوامة is derived from one of the attributes of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Qayyum, which means the one who sustains, provides, take care, look after. So Al-Qawama is not a position of authority. It's a position of accountability, of a position of responsibility. عَلَى النِّسَاءِ, and to the rest of the verse. These, the previous preceding verses indicate that men should treat women justly and fairly and to avoid anything that could hurt them. So this could be understood in line of this context. And just what comes after this verse, the Almighty says, وَعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا وَبِالْقُرْبَى وَالْيَتَامَى وَالْمَسَاكِينِ وَالْجَارِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى وَالْجَارِ الْجُنُبِ وَالصَّاحِبِ بِالْجَنْبِ وَابْنِ السَّبِيلِ. So the Almighty asks us to treat all people, and he detailed many categories of people in this verse. The time doesn't allow me to elaborate on these categories, but the general rule, he's asking us to treat them in the best manner possible. And this best manner, the woman is no exception to this rule. So we should understand the word adarb in the whole context of this. And it is interesting to know that adarb is not the first option, it is the last resort. So it wouldn't be in the heat of the moment. It's likely during the first two stages that the issue has been resolved between the husband and the wife. And also the word barb doesn't mean to hurt or to cause injury to women. This is understood in line on the entire whole context and in line of the prophetic tradition and in line with the explanation of the Prophet's companions, like Ibn Abbas. Ibn Abbas said, it is just with a toothstick, with a miswak. So it is more a symbolic connotation rather than a physical hurt or a physical causing physical injury. It is just a gesture of anger. It could be just by a miswak. Ibn Abbas, who is called Habr al-Umma wa Turguman al-Quran, the Prophet peace be upon him, or he was known, the Prophet peace be upon him, prayed that Allahumma allimhu al-ta'wil. Allahumma faqqahu fi al-deen wa allimhu al-ta'wil. When Ibn Abbas was brought to the Prophet peace be upon him as a newborn, the Prophet made this statement, made this prayer, Allahumma faqqahu fi al-deen, oh Allah, make him well-versed in the jurisprudence of the religion, وَعَلِّمْهُ التَّأْوِيلِ, and teach him the interpretation of the Holy Quran. So this Habr al-Quran, which means the great scholar, Habr al-Ummah wa Turguman al-Quran, the great scholar of the Ummah, and Turguman al-Quran, the chief interpreter of the Holy Quran, interpret here beating as beating them with a tooth stick, with a miswak. And we understand that also in line with the Prophet, peace be upon him, practice. The Prophet, peace be upon him, as Aisha, may Allah be pleased with him, was quoted as saying, مَا ضَرَبَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ بِيَدِهِ قَطْلَ امْرَأَةً وَلَا خَادِمًا إِلَّا أَنْ يُجَاهِدَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. The Prophet, peace be upon him, never hit or beat with his hand, neither a woman nor a slave, illa an yujahida fi sabilillah, except when he goes to jihad fi sabilillah azza wa jalla. So it is a symbolic thing. It's not meant to cause an injury or a physical harm or hurt to the woman. And this is explained in the farewell sermon of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. The farewell of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, Khutbat al-Wada' in Hajjat al-Wada', the farewell sermon of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, serves as a human rights declaration, including the women's rights. The Prophet, peace be upon him, asked us in the farewell sermon, when he was bidding his ummah farewell in his very last sermon, Hajjat al-Wada', he said, فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ فِي النِّسَاءِ, fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in women, فَإِنَّكُمْ أَخَذْتُمُوهُنَّ بِأَمَانِ اللَّهِ وَاسْتَحْلَلْتُمْ فُرُوجَهُنَّ بِكَلِمَةِ اللَّهِ. Until he said, the Prophet peace be upon him says, if you are to beat them, then let that be not فَضْرِبُوهُنَّ ضَرْبًا غَيْرَ مُبَرِّحٍ. غَيْرَ مُبَرِّحٍ means doesn't cause harm or doesn't cause injury and doesn't hurt, which means it is the metaphorical or the symbolic meaning is meant here by barb, not the physical meaning. And Allah knows best. This is my answer.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Sheikh. It, as you said, it's all a question of misinterpretation, misrepresentation, and people can turn and twist anything Correct. That they like their way. Shukran. Correct. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Thank you. I think if there is no other question, we can bring. We have here a comment from Sister Hanna. She's saying, after hearing of all the rights of women get in Islamic teaching, I invite all women rights organization to call globally for the implementation of the Islamic teachings of women rights, because in these teachings is what women's safety, emotional, social, etc. I join my voice to the voice of Sister Hannat, and yes, we call upon all women rights organization, feminist movements, women's movements, to resort to the teachings of Islam, to justly read the Holy Quran, to give justice reading to the Holy Quran, the verses of the Holy Quran, and to understand it in the light of the example of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and only then they will be able easily and correctly to understand this blessing of Allah, the religion of Islam that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed us with. I pray to the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that this short session has been of great benefit to you all. And I hope it is an eye-opening to many issues when it comes to women's rights in Islam. And I pray to the victory for Muslims all over the globe, and that the religion of Islam is established correctly in light of the Prophet's seerah and as implemented by the Prophet, peace be upon him. وَمَا ذَلِكَ عَلَى اللَّهِ بِعَزِيزِ. It is possible, and only we need to meet the criteria that was mentioned in the Holy Quran to obtain or to get so. This criteria is mentioned in the Almighty saying, الَّذِينَ يُمَكِّنَّاهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ أَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةِ وَآتَوُ الزَّكَاةِ وَأَمَرُوا بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَنَهَوْا عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ وَلِلَّهِ عَاقِبَةُ الْأُمُورِ. These are the conditions for the Muslims to be able to spread the religion and to dominate the land. Only when they establish prayer, الَّذِينَ يُمَكِّنَّاهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ أَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةِ, they establish prayer, وَآتَوُ الزَّكَاةِ, they gave charity, وَأَمَرُوا بِالْمَعْرُوفِ, they enjoin what is good, وَنَهَوْا عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ, they forbid what is evil. Only when we implement these things, we will be dominant in the land, we will be able to establish the laws of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as it was established by our great Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Until I see you in our next episode, inshallah ta'ala, I salute you all with the salutation of peace. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And thank you again for being part of this short session. It is recorded, inshallah ta'ala, we will shortly upload it online. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum salam.